Hello people, and today we are going to be taking a look at a 115-watt multicart, which I recently purchased from China. Ooh, or something. Yes, this is a 115-watt multicart. Ooh, blatant noise, as usual. Nah, I'm just kidding. I'm not going to spoil the ending for you, but you can guess yourself if you want. But yes, this multicart is actually pretty awesome, as I will explain. First off, it comes in a box. And how many multicarts can you think of that comes in a box? I'll give you a clue, it's not double digits or more. Two, well, I can't read the text. So it must be awesome if I can't read the text. Okay, maybe not, but yeah. Let's just cut the crap and get to the multicart itself. And yes, plug it in. As they say on an advert that I saw once. Yes, now we're having to use a Famicom to review this thing. For two reasons. One, this thing does not seem to work on a real Famicom. I tried, and the graphics were sort of scrambled, which is vaguely annoying. And two, the sound on my Famicom is not working anyway, so in any case, I'll be using the Famicom. Because I do want you people to see this as soon as possible. So the first game is Contra, which has a 12-in-1 menu for some reason. No, I don't get that either. But yes, Contra 30P, Assault Gun, Loop Gun, and Shotgun. Contra 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Which is funny because there's no 4 through 6 or 8 on this multicart, as you might have noticed. And all of these lead to the same game, so yeah. Yes, Contra. I do apologise for using the Famicom. Like I said, I haven't really got much choice. But hey, at least you'll be able to enjoy perfect sound emulation, aside from the PAL-ness of the emulation. As you can see, it's Contra. I have this on a few other multicarts. Surprisingly common by my experience. But they're getting Contra awesome, so yeah. And yes, I don't think much more needs to be said about Contra other than it is a great game. If you don't have it, I highly suggest you play it at some point or another. Oh yes, now it's worth pointing out that a fair few of these games, especially early on, I've never actually played. At least not before I got this multicart. So don't expect me to be any good at some of them, especially the lesser known ones. So next up is Contra 2, which I've surprisingly not had yet. Yep, it's another menu, all of which again lead to the same game. Kind of pointless really. I'm just going to pick Super Contra because I can. Add that because I haven't really got this on any other multicart, so might as well play it as it originally was, or at least as close as I can. Because as you will see in a second, this particular incarnation does not allow you to play it as originally intended. Because you start off, because even if you pick Super Contra, you still end up with the shotgun. So picking up this shotgun power-up does nothing other than give me points, which is kind of pointless. And yes, it is Super C, or Super Contra, or whatever you want to call it. Known as Pro Protector 2 in Europe, thanks to Germany's stupid laws. I blame Germany because it really is actually their fault for once. Then again, it was also their fault for World War II. Well, actually, I blame Hitler, but then again, Hitler was the main character in Downfall, so can't pin the blame entirely on him. And I'm an idiot. Not much more to say about Super C, other than it's awesome. Contra 3, quote unquote, is actually Contra Force. Surprisingly, they didn't rebrand it as Contra 6, which is an unusual for a multicart. Burns, I'm going to play as him, because it's not like it really matters. Sadly, the character roster is nowhere near as good as the roster in Super Contra 6. And as you may notice, I believe this is a problem with the Famicom, but I could be wrong. Actually, I'm pretty sure it's a problem with the Famicom, come to think of it. Yeah, for whatever reason, if a game starts lagging on this Famicom, I wasn't aware of this at the time, but I reviewed it, but if the games start to lag, then yeah. The graphics sort of glitch up, which is kind of annoying. There's another game where this is a bit of a problem. You'll see this later on. Thankfully, it's only one other game, so it's not too bad. It's still quite annoying. But yeah, Contra Force is a decent game, although nowhere near as good as the first two, mainly because of all the lagging that it suffers from. The lagging was in the original game, just not the glitchiness of the lagging. Not much more to say here. So, game number 4 is Contra 7. You may be wondering what happened to 4 through 6, sorry. I don't know, but yes, Super Contra 7 is a pirate game, as you can probably guess. And I believe, I could be wrong on this, but I believe this game uses the same engine as Super C. P power-up, which just clears all the enemies on the screen, kind of pointless really. And yes, graphics stolen from Mighty Final Fight. And more graphics stolen from Super C, as you can clearly tell. Or maybe the original Contra, I can't really tell the difference. I really don't understand why they sold graphics from Mighty Final Fight. Presumably because they were too lazy to draw their own. And yes, S for spread gun. Now you would expect the spread gun to be the best weapon in the game, but ironically it's probably the worst. Because you can only fire one set of bullets at once, which is kind of annoying, and most of the bullets are kind of useless in this game because of how linear the levels are. There's no multiple paths or anything, at least not in level 1. I did actually play through this whole game once, and when you beat the game, all you get is text. Nothing else, just text. Does that sound like fun? Does that sound like a good game? I thought not. Ooh, laser gun, give me that. Yes, the laser gun actually is quite useful, because it can annihilate enemies. Not going to bother playing through the whole thing, mainly because the first boss is almost impossible. Trust me. So game number 5 is Wrath World. And Wrath World is an epic game. In fact, I even have this in cartridge form, that's how awesome it is. In fact, I even showed this game off in my review of the Famicom I'm using. The Ultimate TV game, in case you're wondering. I'm not going to bother going for the story because I think I'll show that in the review of that. So, kind of pointless really. And yeah, this is basically just Journey to Silius on the NES, as some of you will probably be able to tell already. Except instead of playing as a kid, you play as a robot. Well, was he a kid in the NES version? I can't remember. If I remember correctly, he was. And Wrath World is a pretty awesome game, and I'm sure most of you out there would agree. Although it's kind of hard to see the lasers thanks to the poorly done colours on this stupid Famiclone. But sadly, I'm going to have to put up with it. Not really much I can do about that, like I said. Yeah, dodge that stuff, because those manholes or whatever do hurt, yeah? As stupid as that sounds. And, yes, I'm not going to bother playing through these games, because I don't have the time. And I do want to show off some of the weirder games coming later on. Final Mission, again, pretty awesome game. By Natsumi. And yes, Final Mission is a shooter, as you'll see in a bit. Yeah, I know you can really hear that because the voice sample is a bit quiet in this game. But it is this game is actually known as SCAT, Special Cybernetic Attack Team in the US, or Action in New York, as it was called in Europe. Those versions are a bit different. Several reasons, which I'm not going to delve into here. It's actually a pretty awesome game, this is. As you can probably tell. I like it. I always love these kind of shooters. And yes, what is kind of annoying about this particular version of the game, though, because if you get hit in this version, you lose your weapons, you lose your power-up, which is kind of annoying. I always hate when games do that. But what's funny is that the other versions of the game don't actually do that, which is a bit odd. And yes, I'm not going to bother playing through the whole game. But it is a great game, and I highly recommend you play it. Game number 7 is Cage. Yes, Cage. Not Legend of Cage, it is the other Cage. What's kind of weird is that Legend of Cage isn't even on this thing, I don't think. BS Cage by Natsumi. This is actually the Japanese version of a game that's known as Shadow of the Ninja in the US. And I think it was called Blue Shadow in Europe, although I could be wrong on that. Yes, I'm not sure why it was with Natsu me renaming games for different regions. Then again, you could say the same for Konami, I suppose. And Tecmo, actually, because they're the Ninja Gaiden games. Which were called Shadow Warriors over in Europe. I'm kind of understand it here, though, because after all, I thought there was some weird law saying you couldn't mention the word ninja in video games in Europe for some crazy reason. Not very good at this game, I will admit. I'm normally a little bit better than this, though. It's a bit like Ninja Gaiden in terms of gameplay, although a bit different. Obviously I'm not this bad at Ninja Gaiden, I will say that much. In fact, I'm pretty sure there's a hill that I missed. Oh, this boss is so annoying because he moves so bloody fast, you've got time to avoid him. But he's pretty easy, because you can just mash the B button when you're right next to him. And he's down. See? Okay, now that we come to game number 8, which is Pro Protector 2. Yes, Pro Protector 2. Now, you may have remembered earlier that I mentioned that Super C was called Pro Protector 2 over in Europe. So, yes, it's just Super C again, except with different sprites and higher pitched music. And, yeah. Except, of course, here you actually have to play it as it was intended, it wrote down to the copyrights. I really don't see the point of including this. Like, it's just a waste of a game, really. I mean, what's the point of including Pro Protector 2 when you have Super Contra? It's just pointless. Pointless, I see! Yes, anyway, not much more to say there, so let's move on to F1 Hero. Now this game, I actually have on Gunfighter, where it was rebranded as Dream Rapid. Now, yes, I believe this is the Japanese version of, I think it was called Michael Andretti's Racing or something like that. Yes, let me drive. Yes, now I said in that review that it was a pretty awful game. In the review of the Gunfighter, that is, I said it was a pretty awful game, and playing it in its original form, I still stand by that point. Just the main reason just being that the controls are just awful. Like, you spin out constantly. Like, you literally have to be driving at less than 100 kilometers an hour just to not spin out. See what I mean? It's awful. I mean, couldn't they at least put in like a decent racing game like Micro Machines or... trying to think of some other ones. Actually, there is another one later on, which from what I remember at least is pretty good. But that comes in later on. Wow, I actually got through turn without spinning out, that's a surprise. But yeah, not a very good game. So let's move on to game number 10, which is, according to the menu, Defender City, which may make you think it's Defender. Sadly not, it is actually Defenders of Dinotron City. Now, I remember watching a review of this game on YouTube, and it looked pretty terrible. Yes, Lucasfilm Games. Lucasfilm Games actually make a few pretty decent games, like Empire Strikes Back on the NES. But this is not one of them, as you'll see. Now, the main problem I have with this game is the hit detection, because the hit detection is just terrible. Like, you have to be... it's a bit like Street of Rage, gameplay-wise, sort of. Well, actually, no. Come to think of it, it's more like River City Ransom, except god-awful. Because the enemies constantly run away from you. Like, I'm trying to fight you, you stupid prick. And as you may notice, like, I'm clearly hitting the enemy, and yet it does not count as a hit. Like, I really don't understand why the hit detection works like this, because I clearly hit the enemy there and yet he didn't die. Oh, now he died. And then you free the city. And then you can go into the stores. Okay, I press stop and back into the pause menu. Yeah, you can change characters, but there's not much point. I mean, like I said, hit detection, terrible. And as you may notice, the music is pretty horrible as well. I mean, could they have used a worse sound engine? Well, actually, they could have used the one Samori did, but still would have. But it's still pretty terrible nonetheless. Not much more to say other than it's an awful beat 'em up. Game number 11 is Werewolf. Hadn't really heard of this one, to be honest. But it's a game by Data East. I'm not sure why, but I've tended to be pretty terrible at Data East games. I really don't understand that. But yes, Werewolf. No more heroes. There's a game I could be playing right now. Your time has come. Yes, I will push start, thank you. Don't knock. Now I'll play this one for a few seconds, just to see if it was any good. And who's that meant to be? Ronnie James Dio? I am the spirit of Kinju, and I will be your guide through this quest. A quest I will fail at miserably, because I've never played it before. At least not for more than 3 seconds. Okay, that sounds wrong. Okay, let's see what's going on. Don't knock! Ooh-hoo-hoo, humor! Okay, what? For the hit detection's broken, because I keep hitting him, and yet I'm like half a mile away from him. The hit detection's not very good from what I've noticed, because I'm hitting him and yet my punches are clearly missing him. It's like the complete opposite of that Defend just the Dynatron game I was just playing. This game is a lot better though, because it's not defensive Dynatron. I think that's reason enough to say that it's better. Actually, maybe not. I will explain more later. But for now, it is. And yes, a really easy fighting game. Oh. Okay, maybe it isn't. So I picked up a W and I turned to a werewolf, I think. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's what happened. That was a cutscene. It's like Poltergeist all over again. Okay, maybe not. Can I shoot fireballs? Oh, I can't. Okay, don't knock. Oh, is it like... Is this starting to feel like Kickmaster for some reason? Okay, I'm running around. See what I mean when I say I'm terrible at Data East games? I just have a habit of doing that. Okay, I'm getting the hang of this now. Oh god, it's a ninja! No! I get why there's so many ninjas in so many NES games. It's just a thing of the nights, I suppose. It seems to be a pretty decent game. Oh, do I have to fall down here? Yes, I do. Yeah, I was freaking... No, I'm doomed! Okay, how do I get past this? How do I get past this? There's a pit. Do I have to walk across this? Don't tell me I gotta walk across that. Oh. I wonder if I could climb onto the ceiling. I haven't got a clue, to be honest, but it seems like a decent game. I just don't know how to play it properly. Double Dragon 3 is Double Dragon 3. Not much more I need to say there. But I'm kind of disappointed though, because out of the series, I would say Double Dragon 3 was by far the worst out of the ones on the NES. The main reason being that it is way too difficult for its own good. I mean, also huge on Double Dragon, but Double Dragon 3 is just pish, quite frankly. I mean, I had to manage to defeat him without losing health. That's a rarity. Yeah, it's the Japanese version, so I can't even read the text. And then some more enemies turn up and you can beat them up and get killed trying. Yeah, I was never all that great at Double Dragon, but this game is just impossible. Yeah, I mean, a lot of people, I'm sure a fair few people out there would disagree with me and will just say that I'm just leeching off the AVGN when I say this is a bad game. But I really don't see, just awful. I mean, you only get one life, which in itself is just awful for a beat-em-up, let alone Double Dragon. And the enemies seem to have much better AI than the first two games as well. So they're like, even possible to hit half the time. Okay, I actually made it getting once. I mean, look at this, I'm down to 2 bars already and I've only just left the first building. I mean, it's like, how do they expect anyone to beat this game when you only have one life? It's bloody ridiculous. But yeah, game number 13 is Spider-Man. And this is Return of the Sinister Six. Made by, I think it was Bits. I'm pretty sure it said Bits there. And this one is a mediocre platformer. A lot of people say this game is awful, but I personally disagree. I mean, it's not a good game, but it's not one of the worst games on this multicart. Trust me, there are some terrible games coming up. Or at least a few terrible games coming up. And yes, not a good game. But it is playable, at least. Okay, I clinged onto nothing there, that doesn't even make sense. I mean, what, did I cling onto the background? Based off Spider-Man comics, as you can probably imagine. Yeah, I think Spider-Man himself has a mixed track record when it comes to when it comes to video games in general, actually. Yeah, I mean, this game's pretty mediocre. I mean, the Game Boy game was pretty poor. But I'm sure there were some newer ones that were pretty good from what I've heard. Yeah, based off the films that came out, like, the last decade. And yes, I've played this game before, it's not one of the worst games I've ever played. I mean, it's a lot better than that stupid Dynatron game I was playing earlier. I will say that much. And Double Dragon 3 for that matter, because it's at least playable. Game number 14 is what the menu calls Pow Pow 2. And this is actually, Bubble Bobble 2. Which is an awesome and quite rare game. So yes, I have to commend the pirates for including this one. And yes, awesome game. But again, I think you all know what Bubble Bobble is, so I don't think I need to introduce you to the game itself. And yes, it plays a lot like Bubble Bobble 1, really. Except it's a bit more refined, I suppose. At least in terms of presentation, that is. And yes. Yeah, the colours don't really... Yeah, this Famicom doesn't really seem to like this game, because the colours are a bit bright, and that doesn't go very well with the Famicom I'm using. Which is kind of annoying. Not that it really gets in the way of the gameplay, I just find it to be kind of annoying. Okay, what just happened? I will admit, I haven't really played this game all that much, but I don't understand what happened there. Also, why do you start with 20 lives? I'm pretty sure that didn't happen in the original. Okay, so now we come to game number 15, which is Fighting Road, another game which I never even heard of. And this one is a game in Japanese, great, by Toei Animation, so it's probably based off an anime, although I'm not entirely sure. And this one is basically a fighting game, and from what I've played of it, it's not a very good one. Basically, you punch and kick enemies to death, and it's a bit... I mean, fighting game-wise, it's about as complex as your average beat-em-up, let's just put it that way. Which is not good for a fighting game. Yeah, Street Fighter 2 this isn't. But although, granted, this didn't come out a few years before, so not surprised. Although, I mean, it's kind of like a more refined version of Urban Champion, pretty much. Except the enemies are pretty easy. I mean, look at that, I just owned that bloke. In fact, this game reminds me a lot of, I forget what it was called, it was some sort of unlicensed fighting game by NT Deck. Apologies, I was kind of interrupted there for a second. But yes, let's move on to game number 16. Please excuse me for a second while I go off to facepalm. Okay, now that I've got that out of the way, let us endure the horrors that is Rocky and Bullwinkle. Seriously, this has got to be one of the worst games I've ever played. Let's just put it this way. This game is so bad that it actually makes that Dynatron game look decent. Seriously. I mean, first off, as you can clearly tell, the presentation is absolutely horrible. Graphics are pretty bad, although understandably so, because... I mean, the original Rocky and Bullwinkle cartoon, they weren't exactly too hot either. And yes, as you can tell, as I'm sure you can tell, the music is pretty terrible as well. I mean, yeah, it's almost as bad as the Dynatron game, quite frankly, in terms of musical talent. Not quite as bad, but it's pretty close. Actually, no, this might even be worse, I can't really decide. I mean, Dynatron uses a worse sound engine, but the compositions in this game are just even worse. And yeah, terrible game. Gameplay wise, well, your only real weapon is bombs, and they go in an arc, which does not work. And as you can see, the mechanics in general just do not work. Like here, if I fall down this flight of stairs, I will lose a life. Kind of reminds me of a ninja gun, except a lot worse. And yeah, there is just a horrible game. I mean, look at this. How am I supposed to dodge that? Tell me, how am I supposed to dodge that? I mean, I did try using the bombs, but I don't think they work. Just a miserable excuse of a game. I mean, look at this. Oh, okay, apparently he does turn left. But why didn't he turn left earlier? You know what? I'm not going to bother playing this game anymore. It's terrible. End of story. Game number 17 is Fire Ice, which is actually, as you'll see in a second, it is Fire and Ice, made by Tecmo. And this is actually the sequel to Solomon's Key. In fact, I'm pretty sure the European version was actually called Solomon's Key 2. I'll just have a quick go to here. This game I have played before, so I know what I'm doing up to a certain point. Colours do not work well on this Famicom, as you can tell. Trust me, it does actually look a lot better on a real console. And yes, so Fire and Ice, great game. And yeah, the first world's pretty easy, as I'm sure you can tell. Great soundtrack, great gameplay, good graphics, and a good time. It's yeah, let's forget about Rocky and Bullwinkle. Erase it from our memory. Although we can't, because we're still being in the menu. Bad Dudes. Now, I'm going to go out on a limb and say that I'm absolutely terrible at this game. Okay, I had to press the stop button for it to start. That's weird. But yes, I have played this game before, and I must say I'm pretty terrible at it. The title screen is a bit glitchy, and I don't know why this is. It doesn't look like this in the original, I can assure you that much. Yes, you can play as Blade or Striker. I'll play as Blade just because it's one on the left. Yeah, the graphics are a bit glitchy for some reason. I really don't understand why. The president has been kidnapped by ninjas. Are you a bad enough dude to have a burger with the president? Anyone who gets that reference instantly wins. And yes, Bad Dudes. Ain't never beat him up. Thankfully, a million times better than that stupid Dinatron City one. I mean, it's not great, but it's still better than that. But like I said, I'm terrible at this game. Watch me get game over before I complete level 1. And yes, just like Contra Force, the graphics seem to glitch up every now and then, which is kind of annoying. Take that! Hey, you're supposed to die in one hit, you idiot. Wait, tell I'm not pro at this game. By the way, has anyone else noticed that the music in the stage sounds a lot like the Miami Vice theme? Oh, this bloke's annoying as hell. No, you die now. Wow, suppose I haven't died yet. Normally by this point I get game over. Okay, maybe not, but pretty close to it. But watch me die now. Wow, using actual strategy, and he died anyway. Yes, you have to fight Karnov, who granted is a Daedalus character, but still. Kind of afraid to see. Now I want to jump up the platform. Apparently holding up and B doesn't let you jump up it. Yeah, as you can tell, I am pretty terrible at this game, like I said earlier. Game number 19 is Mission Impossible, based off the movie. This is going to take a while, so I'm just going to eat my dinner while I'm waiting for this game to start. There we go. Now I've played this game before, seems to be pretty good from my experience. Basically, it's a sort of overhead, sort of beat-em-up style, I think. I say beat-em-up, I'm not totally sure on that. Some of the enemies will try to kill you, like that one tried to. Although if you try to punch civilians, you'll sort of get carried away by a helicopter. See, like that. I shot that bloke in a helicopter, and a helicopter abducted me. You have 3 lives, which are represented by the different characters from Mission Impossible. Thankfully, the enemies don't respawn, which is nice. Nor do the civilians that you've killed. Yeah, you can only attack people if they sort of yell at you, I think. Depending on the area. Like, these ones, you can just attack all you want. Problem with this bloke, the second bloke, is that you have to sort of... that you don't actually have a gun, you just have punch and attacks. And bombs. Ha! You die now! Yeah, this will be fun. Game number 20 is Blue Cat, as the menu calls it. But this is actually Blue! I'm blue, dabba doo dabba doo. Nah. Just no. Yes, push start button. Ooh, is that that bloke from the Wrecking Races? I can't even talk today. Yes. As you might be able to tell, this is a Pokemon themed hack of Wacky Races on the NES. And let me tell you now, this makes about as much sense as the original game. And the original game made no sense in itself, because it had nothing to do with the TV show. I mean, seriously, you'd think that if you were going to make a game called Wacky Races, you would make it a racing game. But no, apparently that made too much sense, so instead they made it a platformer. I mean, it's not a bad game, it's just... what does this have to do with Wacky Races? And it has even less to do with Pokemon, because that doesn't even look like Blastoise, it looks like a friggin' blue cat, as the menu said. It just makes no sense. I'm sure that thing that I just upgraded is supposed to do something, but I can't remember what. I mean, the game itself does play pretty well. It's just... it has nothing to do with Wacky Races or Pokemon. So it's just a big WTF. But it is a decent game. So, moving on. Game number 21 is Cuba Revolution, as the menu calls it. And this one is by SNK. Yes, this one is actually Guerrilla War, as it says there. Well, actually, I believe this version is called Guevara, named after the famous Cuban. And based off his life story. Yeah, I'm sure a lot of people are familiar with this game. It's a great game. It's a lot like Ikari Warriors, which kind of makes sense, seeing it's by SNK. Whoops. I have a tendency to kill the hostages by accident. Like that. Not very good at this game, I will admit. I was a bit better at Ikari myself. And Commando, for that matter. Which, sadly, is not included. Or Ikari, for that matter. I kind of wish either of them were included, because they are good games. Thankfully, again, limited continue, so no matter how bad you are at this game, you can still beat it. Feasibly. See, look at me own the stage now, because I've got a tank. And, yes, Tango down. Yeah, he actually rescued someone for once. Form. I keep getting that beeping as the telling you the tank's gonna blow up. Anyway, game number 22 is Donald Land. I was expecting this to be Donald Duck, but no, it is actually a Game Boy Presents. They can't even spell presents, that's just retarded. But yes, Donald Land. I was expecting this to be Donald Duck, but no, it's actually... I think that's meant to be Ronald McDonald, but he looks a bit weird. But because it's called Donald Land, I'm just going to make a reference to McDonald's. Run, 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 Yeah, I haven't really played this game before, as you can probably tell. And yeah, it is obviously McDonald's, because you're picking up hamburgers or cheeseburgers or whatever.
He's Ronald McDonald, the hamburger happy clown. We're the happiest restaurant. It's his favorite place in town.
Oh, now I was trying to quote a 50s commercial, but I kind of messed it up. Yes. Anyway, game number 23 is Super Mario. And do I even need to introduce this game? I've played it so many times. Let's just hope and glitch out the level select thing. Nope, I can't. I suppose I can read that, but yes. No introduction necessary. If you haven't played this game, as I've said countless times before, you are a friggin' idiot and you shouldn't be watching this video. Apologies to anyone who hasn't played this game before, but that's your own fault. Okay, game number 24 is just fighting mode again. Might be a bother because it's just the same thing as the other one. Mario 6 is yes, now we come to a bunch of cheapo hacks with Mario in them. As you will say. Super Brothers 6. Didn't even say Mario. But yeah, as I'm sure you can tell already, this is just a cheapo hack of what's it called? Tiny Toon Adventures, that was the one. Let's see if I can beat this game. I can kind of see why, I mean, it vaguely plays like Mario, I suppose. But when we say it's a complete rip-off, I mean, if you want to play a direct rip-off of a Mario game, go play MC Kids. MC Kids is actually a pretty good game. This is sadly not included. But yes, let's see if I can do this and not die in the process. Yes, I mean, I watched Tiny Toon Adventures as a kid. I liked it because it was a great show. It's a lot like, what was it called? Looney Tunes. Yeah, they didn't really go out of their way to hack this one very well, did they? And most of the characters are still there from the original game. In fact, I'm pretty sure Mario transforms into somebody else when you collect a pebble. Can't remember what. Anyway, game number 25, no, game number 26, sorry, is Mario 9. Yeah, they just pick the most random numbers as they can. But yes, select area, push RLRLABAB. ABABSOFT! No, it isn't. Yes, Super 9 Mario World. They did just take the logo from Super Mario World, apparently. And this game is Adventure Island 2. I'm pretty sure it's Adventure Island 2. And it does seem to be based off the American version, which is rare. We have the Game Boy version of Adventure Island 2, helped by it in its Japanese form. What's also funny is that they're called Super Mario World, and yet you're playing as Luigi. It doesn't even make sense. Okay, I killed that snake, and it didn't even... I didn't even throw anything at it. Does that even happen in the original? I can't remember. But yeah, it's obviously Adventure Island 2, so let's move on. Game number 27 is Mario 10. And as you will see, this one is 10-10 Super Brothers Kung Fu Mario. Whoever invented that name, I have to salute you for being a complete artard. But yes, it is just Jackie Chan's action Kung Fu on the NES. Except instead of playing as Mario... No, instead of playing as Jackie, sorry. You play as Mario. That doesn't even make sense, but whatever. And yes, this is a pretty good beat 'em up, as you will see. It's a lot better. A lot better, as I say, than Defenders of Dinotron City. Because one thing, you get Mario, and in the original you got Jackie Chan. Seriously, why did anything change? I mean, Jackie Chan's famous. I mean, everyone knows who Jackie Chan is. Granted, even more people know who Mario is, but still. Why not leave Jackie Chan in? I mean, Jackie Chan is win. Hell, he even had Toy Subo at one point or another. Seriously, go look it up, he actually did. But yeah, that's irrelevant. But then again, so is everything else I've said so far. And this is a great game. Hey, something that wasn't irrelevant, that's a surprise. A lot better than Dinotron City, as I've said a million times already. And yes, then you get this weird bonus stage, I think. I'm sure it's a bonus stage. At least that's what I remember from the original. Yes, special stage. You do the leap of faith! And that's obviously not Mario, it's just some bald bloke. Yes, apparently leaping gives you 600 points. Yeah, the graphics do not work. No, this Famicom does not want to render the special stage very well. Yeah. I really need to get like one of the older Famiclones that might be able to play this, but still pretty much perfect hardware. And yes, let's jump on the clouds. Can't wait to do the Super Mario Bros. Special stage. So it's coincidental that Mario is in this game. Albeit a badly hacked version. But game number 29. No, I did press stop accident. Now, game number 29 is a... No, game number 28, sorry, is Super Mario 14. And this one is a hack of... I think it was called Kidney 3, but I can't remember. I think it was Kidney 3. I might be wrong. Yes, made by Wario in 1993. Yes, apparently all these hacks were made by Wario as part of his devious scheme to be more recognised or something, aren't they? Yeah, the graphics were changed, so now you have Koopas instead of whatever the enemies were in the original game. It's actually a pretty good game, I will say that much. It, once again, makes no sense for Mario to be here, because last time I checked, Mario was not a ninja, he was just Mario. He's a plumber, he's not a ninja! Yeah, let's move on. Decent game. Makes no sense for Mario to be there. Mario 16 is Joe and Mac. A game which, once again, I am terrible at. And what a surprise, it's made by David East. So it's no wonder I suck at it. And yes. Oh, I couldn't even hit him. Oh, come on. Wow, that life bar is glitched, isn't it? Like, it's like split up into two life bars and it's not even supposed to, I don't think. Yes, it is a pretty good game. I was never big on Joe Matt myself, but it is a pretty good game. It's kind of annoying that you can't even duck under some of the enemies, but let's move on. Game number 30 is Dr. Mario. Or Space Hospital, as this version likes to be called. Seriously, I don't really see why they bothered changing the name. I mean, it says Dr. Mario in the menu, so why even bother changing it to Space Hospital? Anyway, yes, Dr. Mario, classic game. I refuse to call it Space Hospital, because it isn't. What's funny is that I've noticed on some cartridge art shop things, that sometimes they include Dr. Mario on those cheaper multicarts that have like 6 games on them, and sometimes they use artwork from Theme Hospital on the cover for some odd reason. Yeah, because we know the bloke from Theme Hospital looks like Mario. Yeah, right. But yeah, let's move on. Game number 31 is Mario Brothers, or Mr. Mary, as this version likes to be called. As usual for multicarts, because they was like calling it Mr. Mary for some crazy reason. Or the Teletubbies, as it was once called on one of my other multicarts, where it had like 7 games on it. This is a good game. An arcade classic, as they say. And it's a very good game. And yes, let's run around and collect coins while killing Koopas. This makes a lot more sense than the previous games, I'll say that much. Mainly because Mario was supposed to be in this game, unlike most of the previous ones. And yes, game number 32 is Adventure Mario. Ooh, No, it's not. It's actually just Adventure Island. They didn't even bother hacking this one, which is just stupid. Why do they call Adventure Mario on the menu when Mario is not actually in it? That's just stupid. I have this game on a few other multi-keys actually. And for good reason, because this is a very good game. So yes, Adventure Island 2 and Adventure Island 1. I'll buy Adventure Island 2 being a hacked version. And yes.
No! Yeah,
screw this, let's move on. Game number 33, I think, is Mario's Missing. And yeah. I think some of you know what this one is already. I actually have this game on the Super Nintendo, sadly. Let me tell you now, this game is absolutely terrible. I know this because I've played it on the Super Nintendo, and trust me, it is no better there. Mario is Missing sounds like a great name for a game, but sadly it is almost as bad as Rocky and Bullwinkle, if I dare say that. Seriously. Quite frankly, I'd rather this game was missing, because it's just that bad. See, by Radical Entertainment, that pretty much gives away the fact that this game is terrible. I mean, when you made Rocky and Bullwinkle, that's pretty much a giveaway that your games suck. Okay, I know that sentence made no sense, but I don't care. Yes, you have to go to the one at the end. This one seems to be a bit different to the Super Nintendo version. Like, it has a different setup to the Nintendo version, because in the Super Nintendo, there were a couple of different things, but I can't remember them because I don't want to play that game and I erased it from my memory a long time ago. Well, a long time ago, I mean a couple of months. Okay, let's move on to game number 34, which is Home Alone 2. Oh god. Seriously, why did they even include these games? I mean, no one wants to play them. They're terrible games. Seriously, that's supposed to be Harry? If that's supposed to be Harry, then that's... Wow, the text is all glitchy. Probably for the better, because this game sucks anyway. Besides, I've already watched Home Alone 2, so I know the plot to this film anyway. Basically, Macaulay Culkin gets lost in New York while getting attacked by old women. No, that didn't happen in the film. I know this. I know this stuff. Yeah, terrible game, can't be asked to be any good at it, and there's no point being any good at it anyway, because it sucks. Game number 35 is what the menu calls Supper Popo, and this one is just flat out weird, as you will see in a bit. Because it is Super Popo's Adventure, starring the characters from Teletubbies. And as you might be able to tell already, this one is actually a pirate game, very similar gameplay wise to what's called Pocket Monster. In fact, actually, not so long ago, I actually got a multicart with Super Pocket Monster on it, which was basically an unplayable version of Pocket Monster. Yes. Graphics, as far as I can tell, at least the graphics don't seem to be stolen, which is a rarity for these games. And yes. Not a great game. It's still better than Rocky and Bullwinkle, though. Although that's not really saying much. And yes, you basically have to play as Poe from the Teletubbies and get to the end of the level. What's kind of annoying though is that you can't skip to the end level. It might have the same cheats as Panda World, I think it was called. Okay, and the turbo buttons don't seem. Oh wait, no, the turbo buttons do work because I can just speed my way to the end of the level like this, because I'm awesome. Okay. What the hell happened? Okay, I picked that up and the graphics sort of went a bit glitchy. Can someone tell me what the hell's going on? I also love how the character on the top left looks more like a monkey than the Teletubbies. It just looks hilarious. Because it makes no sense. No, I'm not getting hit by you, Bubble. I want to see if I can beat this level before I can go into the next game. See what the next level has to offer. Yeah, I'm just going to use Turbo B, just because it's quicker that way. See, I made it to the end level.
Can you find Lala's ball?
No, because I can't be bothered with this game anymore. I might end up having to play through that game at some point, just to see what the ending's like. But game 36 is The Hulk. I was not aware that there was a Hulk game on the NES, and that's because I don't think there ever was. Yes, The Hulk.
Hmm, I wonder if this looks familiar. I wonder where I've seen this game before.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just Jackie Chan's action kung fu again. Except once again, with different graphics. Although this one, they did change the music as well. I don't get that. See, like, it reminds me of Doom on the Atari Jaguar, where there's no music during gameplay. Doesn't it make sense? But yeah, here they actually put a decent amount of effort into changing the graphics, which is rare for pirates. But yeah, aside from these changes, it's just Jackie Chan's action kung fu. Oh, I also don't get why they call it The Hulk, when that looks nothing like The Hulk. I mean, he's supposed to be green for one thing. They couldn't even get the colour right. Ugh. Not to mention, he's not a giant either. He just looks like a bad edit of Jackie Chan. From what I remember, at least. I mean, I haven't played Jackie Chan's Kung Fu in a while. At least not in its original form. But yeah, yeah, you've seen this already, so moving on. Game number 37 is Silver. Silver Surf? No, it is actually, 2000. No, it isn't. It's Pokemon Silver! Yeah, right. No, it's actually just... It's obviously just Little Nemo. They really did not go out of their way to make it look new. And yeah, not a great game. Well, actually no. Not a great hack, sorry. I mean, it's a great game, it's just not a great hack. Isn't it? Phrase it right next time, Cheaterman. Or Pirate Gaming Heavy. Or whoever I am. I can't remember my identity and this game's in Japanese and I can't read what you're saying. Yes. I'm not great at this game, I will admit. And yes. In fact, what's funny is that some of the graphics from this game ended up being used in Cart Fighter, which is kind of funny. Yes, like I said, not great at this game, so I don't pretend to be. Like, how do I get up here?
How do I get up here, man?
Ah, that's how you get up, apparently. Yes, let's move on to game number 38, which is Juoki, whatever the hell that means. But it is actually, as you'll see in a second, this one is actually Altered Beast. Yes, there was actually a port of Altered Beast for the Famicom, believe it or not. And as you can probably tell already, it is not a very good one. Trust me, I've played this game before on the real Famicom. It is not a great game. No, not a great port, rather. I mean, Altered Beast is a good game, just not on the Famicom. There was also a Master System port of this game, and that didn't look too great either. I mean, it looked better than this, but it still didn't look great. I mean, like, for one thing, the enemies just appear out of nowhere, and I keep getting hit by them. Annoying. Yeah, I'm sure anyone that's ever owned a Mega Drive will know what Altered Beast is. And I'm sure they remember it being better than this. I mean, you don't even get the animations where he sort of changes into a werewolf or whatever. Or was it just a wolf? I can't remember. He was... But you can do this! Because you're awesome! Yeah, it's not the best of ports, but it is a decent game. it's not better than some of the previous games on this multicart. And yes, let's move on to game number 39, which is Galaxy 5000. And this one is actually a racing game by Activision. And this one is actually pretty good, as I will show you in a bit. Start the game, health controls please, and get ready for Race 1 Mercury. Yes, it's a racing game, and it sort of plays like Micro Machines, except a bit different. I mean, first off, with the Alpha controls at least, you have to use the D-pad to move, which is a bit unusual for a racing game. It does actually play quite well. I mean, it controls pretty well. It's a lot. It is a million more. It's a, you know, it's a million miles better than that friggin' F1 Hero. I mean, that game was pretty poor. This one's pretty good. I mean, it's not quite Micro Machines, but it is still a great game nonetheless. And it's something a bit different. You know, a space themed racing game. It's kind of funny because a lot of people say space themed racing games make no sense, but this one's actually quite decent. Anyway, let's move on to game number 40. I think this is the last one that I'll bother covering in this part, because I need to recharge the camcorder after this, or the camera, or whatever. Golgo 13. Now, I will admit I'm not familiar with Golgo 13, not of the games or the anime. I've heard the games are good, but I never really bothered playing them, to be honest. But let's try to get this cutscene higher. Yes, made in 1990. The Riddle of Icarus. Now, this, I believe this game was called The Mafia Conspiracy in America, but I can't remember. I need to watch the anime at some point, because I heard it's pretty good. Yes, in Paris. And yes, people said this game is pretty good, and I really do need to play it at some point. And yeah, it's kind of like a beat-em-up, I suppose, or at least what I've played of it so far. It's pretty decent, actually. By Victor Kai. Victor Kai made a few decent games in their time, like, this game is not easy to control on the Famicom, I'll say that much. But yeah, Victor Kai made a few decent games in their time, like, Magical Dorothy, which was kind of like a rip-off of Mega Man. A surprisingly decent one at that. Help! Help! Hey, you can stand on the fire hydrant, and that's a sign of awesomeness. But anyway, I'm sure this bloke's gonna beat me up in a minute. Ah, maybe not. Kick Fu! Yes, that was a reference. And let's get into the building. Yes, I think, yeah, very good beat 'em up. And one that I probably should have played before, but didn't, because I'm an idiot. But yes, I'll see you later, people, where I go over some of the other games. See you!